to Meg365 Outreach.
Voice of Hope Pregnancy and Family Center providing pregnancy testing, ultrasound, and family education. They have a paid donation bottle here.
Hazard Appreciation Day is today. Cookie Bar Sunday, October 9th, after evening service. So after the evening service, we're going to have cookies to appreciate the pastor.
Sweet.
Literally.
Community Care March, Saturday, October 15th, 3:30 a.m. registration.
8:30.
At Osiris Central.
Buckeye Central.
Okay, so it's this Saturday, starting at Buckeye Central Stadium and ending at the gazebo in New Washington.
And there's no cost.
There's no cost. It starts at 8:30 for registration.
But you get a free t-shirt.
While they last.
Yeah. They usually have.
Blanket Drive, October 16th. You can donate up until October 16th. That is for the flood relief. You can donate sleeping bags and gently used blankets.
Up until the 16th.
Up until the 16th.
Monthly small groups, Friday, October 21st is the next one, and there will be a meal this small group to follow.
Is that all? Okay, there's going to be a Christmas play, and practice will start for the kids in a couple weeks.
If you want or to join or are interested in that, see Becky Seville.
Yes.
Before we start, I would like to have Ryan and Brian come up here.
Ryan.
The twins.
Are you gonna preach?
You guys wanna preach?
We wanna give you guys each a thank you card, but also a little gift certificate that you can choose your prize when you open it and read it. For appreciation for all you guys do for us. Because we know it takes a lot of time and I know you both have the heart of God that you wanna make a difference in this community, and we just lift you up in prayer and want you to keep working for us and keep this going. And we're really blessed to have Pastor Tim as our worship leader.
Yeah, double duty.
Yes.
Well, thank you guys
for an opportunity to do it.
Amen. Hey, Rebecca Plum, and you can do that.
Oh yeah.
We're gonna worship. We're sing some songs out.
So let's pray. We need it. We praise you, Father. We thank you, Lord, again for your presence with us tonight, Lord God, and your goodness and your mercy that is new every morning, Lord God. Great is your faithfulness. Lord God, help us to focus on you tonight, Lord, to have hearts that's ready to receive, ready to give, and ready to receive, Lord, and ready to go out and make your name known in this dark world. We'll give you the praise in Jesus' name. And
hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
Oh,
Name above all names. blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of
sinking sand. So much of the world knows they're on sinking sand, and they like it. But Jesus is a solid rock for believers in him who put their faith and trust in him are still going to be wicked people who need saved by his blood. But they come to him in faith, and Jesus cleans them up. And only Jesus can clean them up spiritually. Let's pray. Again, Father, we thank you for, well, first off, the grace that makes anything good in our lives. The grace that brings us to life spiritually from the dead. The grace that empowers us. The grace that helps us to give to others of the blessings you've given us. And it all comes from you as a gift, Lord, at your loving hands. And as we read today, Lord, we see how different people interact with Jesus. And let us be the ones who are walking in faith with Jesus and not those who reject him and mock him and just brush him off as the world seems to do so often. Help us to walk in truth and faith that's clinging to you and your word by your power to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Faith in action is what we're going to be talking about tonight. Faith in action. Jesus heals a nobleman's son. Okay, so we're going to be going into John 4. You guys remember we were at the woman at the well, caught in, Jesus pointed out how many husbands she's had, and the one she's not with right now is her husband, and she was an outcast in society. But Jesus says, hey, look, I can change things. You come to me, and he'll give that eternal life, that living water. And then she went and told all her friends. And then Jesus stayed there for 2 days and blessed them with his word and his wisdom. And now we are picking up. Jesus is leaving after 2 days with this woman at the well and the others there in Samaria. And it says, so he came again to Cana in Galilee. This is verse 46 in chapter 4. So he came again to Cana in Galilee, where he had made the water wine. And at Capernaum, there was an official whose son was ill. When this man heard that Jesus had come from Judea to Galilee, he went to him and asked him to come down and heal his son. For he was at the point of death. So Jesus said to him, unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. The official said to him, sir, come down before my child dies. Jesus said to him, go, your son will live. The man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and went on his way. As he was going down, his servants met him and told him that his son was recovering. So he asked them the hour when he began to get better. And they said to him, yesterday, at the seventh hour, the fever left him. The father knew that was the hour when Jesus had said to him, your son will live. And he himself believed in all his household. This was now the second sign that Jesus did when he had come from Judea and Galilee. So this guy here had an encounter with Jesus. Now remember, John wrote this whole gospel so that people would recognize that Jesus was the Son of God, the Messiah, the Christ, and all that believe on him will have everlasting life. So all the things he put in his gospel, he's showing Jesus is the eternal Son of God with power by all he's doing. He said, go, your son will live. I don't know what spiritual mechanism God needs to produce miracles. He just wills it. He doesn't have to do any waves of his hand. He doesn't have to speak it. He just can will it. Jesus says, go, your son will live. Here's the verse we're going to concentrate on it tonight. Verse 50, Jesus said to him, go, your son will live. Now listen to this. The man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him. The man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and went on his way. The man believed what Jesus said, and he went on his way. Now, we know from other stories, there's people who hear what Jesus says and says, okay, we can't dismiss his miracles, but he's doing it by the devil. So they weren't believing Jesus. And there's other people who see Jesus, and they want to see other things, and that's not enough for me. There's people living in this day and age who say, not enough evidence. I want to see God. I want to see these things. And they don't put their faith in Christ. This is all spiritual stuff. People want to operate in their senses, in the physical. But this body's going to the dust. This body's going back to the earth. We're true spiritual beings, and we need to operate in the spirit, because that's how faith operates. Faith is a spiritual thing. So, so we're going to go to slide two, which is actually faith in action. You don't have to pull up any more scripture as I go. We'll just keep going on the slideshow. You can have faith and believe something. This guy, the first step was believing the word Jesus spoke. Jesus says, go, your son will live. Now, you know, my daughter Madeline, when she would go and get shots or something growing up, the doctor would be coming with the shot, and she would be like, wait, what's that? What are you doing with that? What's going to happen? No. And the doctor would say, no, it's fine. He said, no. I want to know. How long is it going to take? What's it going to feel like? What's going on? I need more. I need to see. I need to know everything that's going to happen. How long is it going to go? How far is it going to go in? Is it going to sting? What can I squeeze? Mama, get me out of here. Okay? She wasn't believing what the doctor said. Okay, a little pinch, it'll be done. No, she wanted all the details. She wanted more information. This guy doesn't do that. How do I know he's going to live? How do I know? I'm not leaving here until I see something that you're doing that I know that he's going to live. Let me wait until I'll send my servants to go get him and bring him here, and then I'll see that he's lived. But what? This guy doesn't do that. It says the man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and went on his way. That's faith in action, being doers of the word. Don't just, okay, I believe that. Prove it. Put it in action. Get your feet moving. Faith without works is dead, is what James said. 2:26. Well, I got faith. Well, I don't see any fruit. I don't see your faith producing anything. That doesn't tell me there's a living faith. That tells me you're still operating in unbelief. That tells me you want to see to believe. Faith is believing to see. Just live it. I don't know why that makes sense there. Be doers of the word and not hearers only. Deceiving yourselves. So, unbelief in action. That's what you do when you don't operate in faith. You're operating in unbelief in action. You're being hearers of the word only, not doers. I hear it, but I don't believe it enough to put it to faith, to put action to it, to have it produce something living and spiritual that is going to bear fruit. That is unbelief in action. The majority of the world, and we know this because the road to destruction is broad, the majority of the world operates in unbelief in action. I'm not putting faith in anything but my bank account, my heritage. I come from a very wealthy family. I don't have to worry about work. I don't have to worry about money. I'm just going to be a philanthropist. Other people put their faith in whatever, their looks, their muscles. And they don't put faith in God. They put unbelief in God, and they put faith in themselves. So this guy, this nobleman, he heard what Jesus has been doing. He's heard the stories. He goes, my son's going to die. There ain't no physician that's going to help him. There ain't nobody that's going to save him. He's about to be under the ground, buried. Here's the guy who I've heard all these stories about. These miracles. The good wine that he turned that water into. That lady from Samaria, everybody thought she was crazy. But no. He is the Messiah. He is this one they call the Christ. And he put his faith in Jesus into action. He came to him. And he said, here's what I need. I'm going to trust you for it. And it says he believed him. He didn't do research. He didn't say, I've heard people say, I've studied all the world religions. He didn't say, let me go see what the other world religions say and how they can help my son be healed. He trusted Jesus. There's other people saying, I came back to the Bible. I know one guy, Hugh Ross, we were talking about. He was an atheist. He's an astrophysicist. And he went and studied all the religions of the world. And he came back to Christianity. He goes, this is the only one that makes sense. This is the only one that you cannot find holes in. This is the only one that's like, wait a second. This is empty. This is void. This is a man's attempt to do their own bidding and make their own way. And he came to Christianity, and he's a great apologetics guy. He talks about astrophysicists, stuff out there in the universe, and he relates it to God. And it's so awesome to listen to him. But if you actually do your research with not only your brain, but your inner being, your soul, and you seek God, he's going to show up. It's not like he's not there already. Do not deceive yourselves. If you say you have faith and there's nothing that shows, if you can't look back and go, whoa, look at that trail of all his things that his faith produced. This guy, this girl, man, look at all that faith is doing. They're having an impact. They're making an impression in this world. They're doing things for the kingdom. That's faith in action. Not unbelief in action doesn't have results like that. It has selfish results because it's from selfish motives. This man believed. This is what Paul says to Timothy. He says, fight the good fight of faith. Here's what we're talking about. Faith in action. This guy had an encounter with Jesus. Some people embrace Jesus. Some people reject Jesus. This guy embraced Jesus. And he has an outcome. At the end it says he and his whole family were saved. That is the multiplicity of the kingdom of God. You think that Samaritan woman wasn't telling everybody about this guy who knew everything about her? You think the people that sat at Jesus' feet for those 2 days in that Samaritan village didn't go out and tell the world what they've witnessed? I bet some of them said, nah, I'm not buying it. Because we know the world is wicked and deceitful. And a lot of people don't want it. Why does it say they don't come into the light? It says because they like the darkness. They like their evil deeds. And the light exposes them. That's called an evil, wicked, selfish heart. And we all have that before we give our lives to Christ. We have a stony heart that rejects God. And Jesus cuts that stony heart out and puts that soft heart that it receives from God. It embraces God. It is empowered by God, that fleshy heart. And it is alive. And that's all by faith in action. So fight the good fight of faith. Faith is a fight. Because we are in a battle. That's why he's telling Timothy, fight the good fight of faith. This isn't a tea party. Go have a good time with a tea party of faith. He says, fight the good fight of faith. And when Paul talks about wrestling against flesh and blood, he's talking about a struggle where you're exerting everything you have in this struggle. You are wrestling. This is a fight to the death. That's what it is. It's spiritual warfare. It's a kingdom of darkness against the kingdom of light. It's life and death. It's blessing and curse. It's Savior, the cross, or denial of the Savior and condemnation. He's saying, fight the good fight of faith. All right, we're going to do some trivia. Well, it's already up there. So faith in action. Look at the definition of action. The fact or process of doing something, typically to achieve an end. So let's take that word out of there. Faith in action. Let's replace it with some of these words. Steps, measures, activity, movement, work, effort, operation. Your faith is doing something, right? Action. Now get this. The word action is also used in another way. Action could be an armed conflict. We had the Vietnam War. We had World War II. Korea wasn't a war. It was a conflict. It was called a military action. You guys ever heard about, a KIA, killed in action? That was in the process of an armed conflict. This person was killed. So action inside of that. Servicemen listed as missing in action during the war. They're missing in action. An armed conflict. And also steps, operations, doing things. So our faith is vibrant, alive, and it's in the midst of a battle, of a war, of a conflict. Fighting, hostilities, battle, warfare, combat, conflict. Our faith in action is mobile. It's boots on the ground. It's feet going. We are the hands and feet of Jesus. Hands do stuff. Feet go places. This is faith doing stuff, going places in the midst of a conflict, which is a spiritual battle we're all in. I said I'll try not to yell today because you said the camera picks me up. I've kind of thrown that out the window. Now, we're going to see what would happen in some Bible stories that everybody knows if they operated in unbelief in action or faith in action. Because we got people in the Bible, and you can see the people who operated with unbelief in action, and you can see the people who operated with faith in action. Okay, now, this is going to be, if you look up there, there was a Bible person. If he did not operate in faith, this is what would have happened to him. He died in his old age in the land of Uz. A father with only a few descendants, surrounded by pagan worship, and only having a five-letter name instead of a seven-letter name. Okay, his name was Abram. And his name would have remained Abram when God says, I need you to go where I'm going to send you. He would say, no, I don't believe you have the best interest. If he was operating in unbelief and action, he would have never left Uz. He would have never had Isaac and Jacob and the 12 tribes that came from Jacob and the descendants of the earth as stars in the sky. And he would not have been the father of faith. His name would have been Abram. Another person who had an encounter with God and rejected it. Abram embraced it. He had faith in action. And now he's known as Abraham, the father of the faith. The spirit of Abraham. Everybody knows Abraham. Even Muslims love Abraham. This man who put faith in action. Abraham, I already gave it away. Abraham, a man of faith in action. Okay, who's this guy? And he died in his old age on the far side of the wilderness alone. Only he and his father-in-law's sheep and a land that was never promised to him. That's Moses. Moses, you're going to set my people free. Now, I'm good, God. I'm going to stay here. I'm raised by Pharaoh's daughter. I'm in the court of the most powerful nation in the world. I got it pretty good. I'm going to do my thing here. You go ahead and worry about Egypt and worry about the king and your plagues and all that. I'm going to stay here with my father-in-law's sheep. I ain't going to no promised land and I ain't going to lead no people to promised land. So I gave that away. He never made it to the promised land because of his disbelief or disobeying God. But Moses, a man of faith in action, God said, jump. Moses said, how high? God said, go to Pharaoh. He said, I can't talk. Moses, come on. I got you. Take your brother with you. Now, get it done. And Moses got it done. That's faith in action. Who's this? And he died just a youth, having been run through by Goliath's giant spear, and the birds of the air feasted on his flesh. We talked today. David didn't mess up. We talked about Satan getting in his ear and saying, you better count your army before you go up against these guys. Make sure you can do it. And instead of David saying, wait a second. God, help me kill a bear and a lion. That doesn't happen. God, help me slay a giant, a guy of war, a guy who's been about war and killing people all his life. And God, help me kill him. He messed up when he counted his army. But David could have just said, man, that guy's really doesn't like us Israelites. Anybody going to do a killing? Because that's what everybody's doing. Nobody was doing anything. Everybody was too scared to go confront Goliath. And David heard what Goliath and those guys were saying. He goes, whoa! Pump the brakes, y'all. Do you hear what he's saying about our God? And he goes, no. Give me, I'm going in. I'm going in with God. And in the king, and Saul says, whoa, hey, this is a man of war. What did David say? God did this for me. God did this for me. And God's going to deliver this giant into my hands. That's faith in action. And I said it before. Before David even tried on that chainmail and said, no. God's got me. Before David even picked up the 5 smooth stones, before David even loaded a stone, he already saw Goliath's head in his hand that he cut with Goliath's own sword. That was a faith. That was a vision. Seeing not to believe, but believing and see it. He knew he was going to be victorious because he had God on his side. God was the one he was trusting. God was going to take care of the giant, not him. He was just going to be the vessel. Like Isaiah says, here I am, send me. I'll go. Isaiah knew he didn't have a whole lot of spiritual power to contribute. He was going to be a willing vessel for God to use. So he was putting his faith in God and putting it to action by saying, I'm going to go. So faith in action is going. Abraham was a man of faith in action. Moses was a man of faith in action. David was a man of faith in action. Okay, who's this? And she lived the rest of her life, a sick woman with an uncured issue of blood, believing that she could not approach the Lord. And there's people that are like that. Dude, I am too wicked. You don't know what I've done. I know I'm going to hell. You don't know what I've done. No. Anybody can approach God in faith and say, here I am, Lord, a wretch. Only you can clean me up. I give my life to you. And all that junk you've done, he goes, hey, I paid for that on the cross. My blood covered that. It's finished. You're now a child of mine. We're going to do this together. Now you went from being an enemy of God to being a child of God. By faith. Putting your faith to the test. So who's this? This is the woman with the issue of blood. And if you're perpetually bleeding all the time, that would be a big issue, I imagine. She put her faith into action. No doctors. I'm broke because I tried to have man fix it. I'm broke because I tried everything else. I'm going to go to the one who's been healing people, who's been curing people, who's been giving people vision, eyesight. What's this? What's this issue of blood I've had for all these years to this man, this possible Messiah, this God in the flesh, perhaps? And she was healed when she touched the hem of his robe. And he lived the rest of his life a blind beggar, believing that the Lord would not have mercy on him. Oh, son of David, have mercy upon me. What did blind Bartimaeus, his buddy, say? Shut up! Quiet down! See, there's two different things. You see the picture of the friends pulling away the thatch on the roof to get to Jesus. I gotta get to Jesus. It don't matter. Jesus moves mountains to get to us when we need help. And our faith might need to move some thatch. You know, man, I've been waiting and praying for this for so long. Yeah, you might. Okay, you're on the roof praying, but you might need to remove some thatch. You might need to go deeper. You might need to start fasting. You might need to start doing these spiritual disciplines. But look at his friends. That's what you do. You do whatever it takes to get people to Jesus. His friends are saying, shut up, Bartimaeus. You're making a scene. Don't draw attention over here. Now, they wore like jackets, so people knew that they were blind beggars and were destitute and couldn't earn any money. So people would give them alms so they could survive. And if you read that story, it said Bartimaeus took off that vest or whatever it was that indicated that he was sick, unable to support himself, in need of alms and help from society. It says he took that off and ran to Jesus. The world tries to hold you back. The world tries to say, this is the way you are. This is the way you were born. It's okay. God's going to love you because. And the world does that all. We've heard a story. This lady we were talking to the other night, she goes to a different church. Her daughter was a guy, now a girl, or one of the first vice. It should be first vice. And her husband goes to a gay-affirming homosexual. It's okay for gay pastors and to marry gay people in the church, and they're just children of God also. And I understand we all sin and we need that forgiveness. But it's like, okay, she had to break away from her husband. She goes, I can't sit in this church anymore. He said, just give it a year. She goes, my spirit can't take this anymore. I've got to get out of here. They're preaching from other books. It's not just the Bible up on the pulpit. Now there's other books coming. What's going on? We need to stay focused on Jesus. We need to be like blind Bartimaeus. Just give it another year. Stay here with me and worship this unbiblical, ungodly stuff. And maybe it'll grow on you. That's what Bartimaeus' friends are telling him. Keep your jacket on. This is who you are. You were born blind, Bartimaeus. That's the way God made you. Your parents must have done something in the past. Just shut up. You're making us look bad. No, that's what the world does. You give your life to Christ. If you go and put your vest, that was operating in faith. When he took that jacket off to show he was blind and in need of societal help, that was faith. He says, I'm coming back with vision. I'm going to the one who can restore my vision. I don't need this jacket anymore. That's faith in action. He didn't say, I better hold on to this just in case. He goes, I ain't going to need this anymore. He already saw his vision restored by Jesus before he even got up. So if you're hanging around those people that say, just stay in this church that's got your spirit all in an ire, and you're grieving the spirit, just stay here with me, because this is my comfort zone. No, you got to be like Bartimaeus. You got to leave your friends who are telling you to stay here, that are telling you, you quit doing this and partying and doing things that make you happy. You're not going to have fun anymore. What's that old song? I'd rather laugh with the sinners than die with the saints. Billy Joel, I'd rather laugh with the sinners. That's what the world says. I'd rather laugh with the sinners than die with the saints. Because sinners are much more fun. Only the good die young. You know that song? Sinners are much more fun. That's what the devil tells us. That's what blind Bartimaeus' friends are saying. No, you're good just where you are. You don't need any of that holiness, that righteousness, that healing. You don't need a new life. You don't need to be born again. You're already born. You don't need to be born from above spiritually. Don't believe that lie. Put your faith in action. Blind Bartimaeus, a man of faith and action. Put feet to your faith. That's what it's all about. Don't just say, yeah, I believe in God. But the trail you leave behind is one that doesn't show nothing but rotten fruit. So, the nobleman was a man who put his feet to his faith. Faith in action. So I'm going to pray to end as the band comes up. So look, we're going to be talking about another healing next week. Look what John is showing everybody. The band, we got a slim band tonight, but it's beautiful praise music going up to the throne. And I know all the angels are grooving to Becky and Tim up here. So we're going to be talking about another healing next week. So look what John's showing. He's saying, look what Jesus is doing. This is the Son of God. He became flesh. He's turning water into wine. He's fixing situations. He is helping Nicodemus understand. He's helping a woman who's from Samaria understand that she doesn't have to be a spiritual outcast. Society might call her an outcast, but she is a somebody to be an asset in the kingdom of heaven through faith. And now he's saying, look what Jesus is doing. He's healing people just by thinking it. It's going to continue next week. So make sure when you talk to people about Jesus, you say, look at these encounters people had with Jesus. Some embraced him, some didn't. Don't be a rejecter of the only way to salvation through Jesus. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I was down at the Ark this week and at a pastor's conference, and Ken Ham was speaking. He was talking about how he challenged Bill Nye, the science guy, and he asked him a question. The question was, what happens to you when you're dead, when you die? He says, you're done. Bill Nye says, you're done. And he said, well, then what? What does it matter? What does it matter what you do? No matter what you accomplish, you're never going to enjoy it. You're never going to know it. You're never going to know what it's done with it. And that really hit me. That's ultimately, in this song, I brought this up because this song is called A Living Hope. Do you have a living hope? Are you alive and have a hope for the future? Without the Lord, there is no future, period.
Right?
You're done. That's what he said. And that's that. And Jesus shows that's not true, because he rose from the dead. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So let's praise him for that living hope we have. Let's stand. How great is our God.
His glory, praise his name. How great thou art should be the spirit that we have in us as we go through our daily lives. Amen. Good to see everybody. Have a blessed week. Love on somebody out there. Just go up to a stranger and hug them and just see how appreciative they are.
Amelia does that.
Yeah. My daughter does that. And a lot of times they are. All right, don't try that.